Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Pasta Mortem by Ellery Adams and Rosemary Stevens. Narrated by Karen White. Chapter 1. Head librarian James Henry pushed away from the table with a satisfied sigh.
Jillian, that pizza was delicious. But I've got to lose weight. My fat clothes are tight, and when Murphy photographed me for the Star, I had to fight the urge to hide my middle behind the library counter.
A collective groan sounded from his four friends. The supper club members sat around the table in Jillian's periwinkle blue kitchen, a platter containing the crumbs of their meal, a testament to their appreciation for the tasty food. James continued,
"It's been like a line of dominoes falling, and I don't mean the pizza kind. Well, maybe that, too."
James paused, then ticked off events on his fingers.
"That cruise Jane and I took last summer where it seemed like we had 8 meals a day. The stress of Elliot starting kindergarten, Halloween's leftover candy, the huge meal Milla cooked for Thanksgiving and the leftovers, Lindy and Luis's wedding reception, and then a tidal wave of Christmas treats. I got on the scale this morning and didn't realize the contraption could count that high."
"Tell me about it," Bennett Marshall said. "Statistics show that the average American only gains 1 to 2 pounds over the holidays, but I don't believe it. Plus, I've been stopping at the 7-Eleven again, picking up food. I had to cover a box of donut holes with a priority mail package when Murphy took a picture of me in my mail truck. I leaned out the window and gave a friendly wave in my photo for the Star, so Murphy couldn't see my gut hanging over my belt."
Jillian O'Malley, owner of the Yuppie Puppy, swung her head toward him so fast her auburn curls whirled about her face.
"Bennett, donut holes are full of sugar and empty calories. Do you want to be on medication for diabetes? Our bodies are temples and must be treated with respect."
Bennett scowled at his sweetheart. "Woman, I don't want to be on medication, but I have to do something about the stress caused by those evil canines on my route."
Lindy, a Brazilian beauty and high school art teacher, fresh from her honeymoon with high school principal Luis Chavez, chimed in.
"Stress, I can relate to that. On the one hand, I've never been happier now that Luis and I are married. But on the other hand, dealing with Luis's mother drives me straight to my stash of candy bars."
"Didn't she go back to Mexico after your wedding?" James asked.
Lindy shook her head. "I wish. Alma's been staying with us since we returned from our trip. I made the mistake of telling Luis I wanted to change things up at the house. You know, put my own creative energy to use and update the carpet, lamps, artwork, and drapes. Oh, my goodness. Turns out Alma picked out those decorations and was madder than a wet hen that I wanted to change them. Milky Way bars, here I come."
"Did Murphy take your photo, too?"
Lucy Hanover, dressed in her brown and beige sheriff's deputy uniform, asked.
"She sure did. Sitting at my desk at school, I was able to hide my midsection. And I remembered to make sure my drawer full of candy was closed tight so she couldn't see. Murphy made me pose in front of my Jeep. A full body shot."
Lucy tugged at her shirt as if trying to smooth it over her bulging tummy.
"I guess that was better than if she'd made me sit inside the vehicle. When I opened the door, Murphy would have seen all the empty fast food wrappers and maybe even my emergency can of frosting. I'm stressed out, too."
"What's bugging you, Lucy?" Bennett asked.
"Sully, another deputy, and I are, well, we've been seeing a lot of each other. Exclusively."
Lucy's brows furrowed.
I mean, I'm not seeing anyone else. Sully's so hot in his deputy's uniform, though. He gets a lot of looks from other women. It makes me edgy. I don't have a very good track record when it comes to men, but French fries and I have always had a great relationship.
James thought of his own obsession with cheese puffs. He cleared his throat. Since he and Lucy had dated before his ex-wife, Jane, and their little boy, Elliot, had come back into his life, James felt uncomfortable when Lucy mentioned her past relationships. They were friends now, thankfully, and James had seen Lucy and Sully out together on more than one occasion. Sully may be attractive to other women, Lucy, but from my perspective, I think he appreciates what he has with you. Lucy's cornflower blue eyes brightened.
You think so? James nodded.
Any man who feeds his lady spoonfuls of apple cobbler with vanilla ice cream in the middle of Dolly's Diner, the epicenter of Quincy's Gap, has declared himself.
Lucy reached over and gave his arm a brief squeeze. Thanks, James. How is Jane? Eating pickles and ice cream?
No cravings. The baby's due at the end of February, so she has a little less than a month to go.
She's really had a rough time of it, Lindy said. Luis and I would love a baby, but I don't think I'd like being pregnant after seeing how Jane's suffered.
James thought of his beautiful wife, weak from being sick in the mornings, looking after an active 5-year-old, and teaching her distance learning classes at James Madison University in nearby Harrisonburg, and couldn't help but feel guilty. He knew it was irrational, but he couldn't bear to see her feeling poorly. The doctor had assured them that sometimes women were sick in the mornings all through their pregnancies. She'd said there was nothing to be concerned about as long as Jane kept down enough nutritious meals and her vitamins. James trusted the doctor, but he still worried. Jane rarely complained, which made James more determined to do all the housework, get Elliot ready for kindergarten each morning, do the grocery shopping, and make sure Snickers the dog and Miss Pickles the cat had fresh food and water. In fact, anything he could do in the way of chores, he did. Jane begged him not to coddle her, but how could he not? She was carrying their daughter and deserved to be coddled. Jane had a good day, or I wouldn't have come tonight.
I, for one, feel grounded and spiritually replenished by the presence of my friends. It's been too long since we've shared a meal together, Jillian declared,
as she moved a ceramic figure of two dolphins kissing to one side and passed around bowls of fruit salad. She took a piece of pineapple out of her own bowl and offered it to Dalai Lama, her tabby cat. He licked it first as if to test its worthiness, then snatched it from her hand and chewed happily. The close friendship of the supper club members had strengthened over years of shared dinners, even if their waistlines hadn't always grown smaller. James looked around the table and reflected on the number of times he and his friends had worked together in the name of justice, identifying people who had committed murder. Fortunately, nothing like that had happened recently, but they made a good team. Each person possessed unique gifts and abilities.
We might not have liked Murphy taking our photos, James said, and his friends murmured their agreement. But I think it's nice that she's using her newspaper to bolster community spirit. She took Pop's photo, too, one of him at his easel, and one of Milla behind the candy counter at Quincy's Whimsies. Nice, Murphy?
Bennett scoffed and speared a chunk of apple.
After the way she embarrassed us all by writing those mystery novels, the characters that looked and acted like us and a plot like one of our investigations. I'd say featuring us in the Star is the least she could do to make it up to us.
When is this Spirit of Quincy's Gap article supposed to appear? Lucy asked, with a hint of suspicion in her voice. James chewed a piece of pear. It sounded like Lucy had doubts about Murphy's honesty as to why she'd taken all their photos. The same doubts James had been having himself. He swallowed. "She hasn't said," he admitted, anxious to change the subject. "So does anyone have an idea about a new diet?" Jillian looked triumphant.
"You've already started it."
Four sets of puzzled expressions greeted this statement.
"I've been thinking about losing weight again myself," Jillian said. "Even though I try to keep my chakras aligned, the stress of not being able to hold my beloved's hand in public or kiss him for fear of what some people might say. Woman! Everyone knows we're together, Bennett," Jillian asserted. "It's the 21st century. People have accepted that interracial relationships happen."
"Not in a small town in Virginia, they haven't," Bennett argued. "And they may know about us, but they don't want to see us kissing and cuddling."
"How will you know unless we give them a chance?"
Bennett tugged at his mustache.
"I don't want to talk about it. Let's hear about this diet."
Jillian pursed her lips, then turned to address everyone.
"Tonight, you've all dined on goat cheese and spinach pita bake, or pizza, as James called it. All the ingredients are acceptable on the Mediterranean diet. The pesto sauce, pita bread, tomatoes, and goat cheese. Of course, the fresh veggies are appropriate for any diet."
"What else can we eat on the Mediterranean diet?" James asked.
"The menu is huge," Jillian answered.
She walked over to the granite countertop, picked up some papers, and handed everyone a sheet.
"Here's a list of foods. Think Greek, Italian, even Moroccan dishes, fish, nuts, olives, hummus, low-fat cheese. You want to exchange unhealthy fats for healthy ones. So good for the heart and brain."
"What about meat? I'm not going on any diet where I can't have my red meat," Bennett declared. "I don't see it on the list."
"In moderation, Bennett, but fish, eggs, poultry, some cheeses, and Greek yogurt should be our primary sources for protein. I'll do a vegetarian version of the diet myself."
James hid a grimace behind his hand as he studied the sheet. A meat and potato man, he'd never cared much for seafood unless it was drowning in a sauce that masked the taste. Since his son had decided to become a vegetarian, James had eaten a lot less meat, but he hadn't totally forsaken it. He told himself to look on the bright side. Chicken and some red meat were okay. Maybe this could work.
"What about dessert?"
"Fresh fruit, James," Jillian said with a smile, "like the fruit salad you're eating."
"All these fruits are available now? In February?"
He looked at her skeptically.
"Yes. Oranges, apples, grapefruit, kiwi, bananas, pears. Go to the produce section of the grocery store. You'll be surprised. There might even be some pomegranates," Jillian said, excitement growing with every word. "And frozen fruits are good, too."
Lucy looked downcast as she rubbed a finger on the paper, her fruit salad barely touched.
"A pear isn't exactly my idea of dessert."
James exchanged a dubious look with Bennett. He had a powerful sweet tooth and knew Bennett did too.
"But you'll feel better, Lucy," Jillian assured her. "You'll look your best too, because not only will you be losing weight, you'll be eating healthy foods instead of junk. Your skin will glow."
"I'd like that," Lucy said. "Sally and I will be patrolling the Hearth and Home TV show reunion festivities down in Cardinal's Rest. A lot of the cast is expected to be there. I had a big crush on Joshy, the oldest boy, for a couple of years when I was younger. I saw pictures of him on the internet, and he's still a heartthrob."
"I'll never forget Hearth and Home," Bennett said. "When the show was on back in the late 80s, I used to watch it with my mom. I got the idea of being a mailman after watching the friendly Mr. Jakes deliver the mail to the Lewis family.
Jillian tilted her head.
I didn't know that's how you decided to become a mailman, Bennett. I, too, watched the show. Such positive vibes and messages of hope and goodwill. A wholesome blending of families after each suffered the pain of losing a spouse.
No one said anything for a minute. The supper club members had only recently learned that Jillian herself had lost a husband, a man she'd married when she was 20 and who had died not long after. Bennett put his arm around Jillian.
"We'll pick some events and go if you want," he said gruffly.
Jillian nodded and leaned against him. James could sense that Jillian's heart had never forgotten her lost love, even though she had Bennett now. He said,
"I remember Hearth and Home was on Thursday nights. Like Bennett, I watched the show with my mom. She said it reminded her of a modern version of the Brady Bunch. I'd like to go to a few events."
"Can we get back to talking about the diet?" Lindy asked. "What about wine, Jillian? Is that on the list? Luis likes a glass with dinner, and so do I."
Lindy ran her hands through her sleek black hair.
Jillian pulled away from Bennett and nodded.
"Like red meat, wine is okay in moderation."
"Do we have to count calories?" Lucy asked.
"No counting calories," Jillian pronounced.
James liked that. He didn't want to have to think about numbers every time he put food in his mouth.
"I'm game. I'm in," Bennett said.
"Me too," Lindy said. Lucy sighed.
"I need to do something. Might as well be the Mediterranean diet."
Jillian clapped her hands.
"I'll find some recipes and email them to everyone tomorrow."
"Thanks, Jillian," Lucy said. "Too bad we didn't get together a few weeks ago and start the diet. I could have had that glowing skin you mentioned in the photo Murphy took. Maybe that Spirit of Quincy's Gap feature she promised will be in this Sunday's edition of the Star."
James looked around the table at his friends and knew they were each thinking the same thing he was thinking. Had Murphy told them the truth? Had she taken photos of each of them for her newspaper? If not, what was her motivation? Murphy had shown herself to be ambitious and ruthless in getting what she wanted. She'd built herself a kingdom, or rather a queendom, with her astronomical book sales. She'd bought the town newspaper, the Shenandoah Star-Ledger, and a big house on Main Street. No one got in the way of whatever it was that Murphy Alastair wanted. James felt a ripple of unease. He looked at his watch.
"I'd better get home to Jane and Elliot in time to read him a bedtime story."
Jillian got up.
"Wait, James. I have a fruit salad for Jane for you to take home."
She opened the stainless steel refrigerator, took out a brown paper bag, and handed it to him.
"Thanks, Jillian," he said, and gave her a hug.
Lindy helped Jillian clear the table. Everyone else shrugged into warm coats, hats, scarves, and gloves to brace themselves against the freezing temperatures, then chuckled as they tried to wrap each other in hugs before leaving for the night. Outside, the bitter winter air stung James's face. He looked up at the clear night sky and wondered if they'd finally get that big snowstorm the meteorologist kept promising. He waved to Lucy as she got into her Jeep, then climbed into his old Bronco and turned the key. Nothing happened. The motor was dead.
Chapter 2.
"No, no, no, not again!" James yelled and pounded the steering wheel. "I need to get home."
James saw the red taillights of Lucy's Jeep disappearing down the street. Not that she'd be able to help. It wasn't like the car's battery needed a jump.
This was the third time the old Bronco had given up the ghost in the new year. The first time, for $75, he'd had the vehicle towed to a shop in Harrisonburg. $500 later, the Bronco had a new fuel pump and a promise that the problem had been fixed. 2 weeks later, the car shuddered to a stop on Interstate 64 outside Richmond, where James had attended a regional library conference. He'd made a call to one of his Richmond colleagues, who recommended a shop in town. $100 for a tow, plus $400 for an ignition module later. James was once again on his way with assurances that the Bronco was fixed. Now he sat drumming his fingers on the steering wheel, wondering what to do. Out of the corner of his eye, he saw Jillian and Bennett come outside. They didn't have coats on and hurried to the truck door. James rolled down the window.
"What's wrong, James? Are you all right?"
Jillian asked, shivering. "The Bronco won't start.
My man, how long are you gonna hold on to that dinosaur?"
Bennett asked.
"As long as I can. Who can afford a new car nowadays? I better call a tow truck."
"Wait," Jillian said.
"A young man named Ace started coming into my shop for dog food with his dog Bacon last summer. Bacon's the sweetest bloodhound mix, but I saw right away that the poor thing had two ticks behind her ear that she kept scratching. I got rid of those with baking soda and some apple cider vinegar. Anyway, are you going to get to the point, woman? I'm freezing my butt off out here,"
Bennett complained.
"Go on back inside, Bennett. I'll be right there,"
Jillian said, her breath visible in the night air.
"James, Ace is what you call a mobile mechanic. You could call him and he'd come over and get your truck started. I have his number in the house. Come inside where it's warm."
James didn't take long to think it over. A mechanic who would come to him would be faster and maybe cheaper than towing the truck to the mechanic in Harrisonburg.
"Okay, thanks."
Jillian turned and hurried back to the house. James leaned his head on the steering wheel and said,
"Listen, Bronco, I don't have the money to keep getting you fixed. What am I supposed to do? I've got a pregnant wife and a son waiting for me."
Feeling like 10 kinds of a fool for talking to the truck, James rewrapped his scarf around his neck. When he reached to take the key out of the ignition and join Jillian and Bennett, he turned it one more time on impulse. To his astonishment, the Bronco started right up.
"Good truck," he cried. "I'll get you some premium gas as the treat tomorrow."
Without turning the engine off, he got out and went to Jillian's door. She said,
"Maybe the truck was cold, James."
James didn't meet her eye. Instead, he looked at the polished front door fitted with leaded glass panes.
"I hope so. I doubt my own judgment sometimes, Jillian, especially when it comes to an important financial matter like replacing the truck."
Jillian put her finger on James's chin and turned his face toward her.
"You stop that right now, James. It's never easy making big decisions in life. Choices when large amounts of money are involved can be tricky. Give yourself credit for not rushing into anything. You know, you're not the same man as when I first met you, when all of us formed the supper club."
"Why do you say that? It's not like I've slimmed down and have rock-hard abs."
"It has nothing to do with the way you look. The changes are on the inside. Don't you know how much more confident you are? When we formed the club, you'd lost Jane, you'd lost your mother, and you'd given up your teaching job at William and Mary to come back to Quincy's Gap and care for your father. You were insecure and miserable. Now, you're sure of who you are, and unless I'm mistaken, you're happy about the most important things in life: love, family, friends, work.
James thought for a moment, then said, "If that's true, it's because of the love and support from my friends and Jane and Elliot." Jillian nodded.
"We all flourish when surrounded by love. Keep an open mind about your truck. Here's Ace's number in case you ever need it."
James accepted the slip of paper and tucked it into his wallet. "Thanks, Jillian." He gave her a long hug. "Tell Bennett I said goodnight." He jogged back to the truck, which had him safely back at his little yellow two-story house on Hickory Hill Lane in less than 10 minutes. "Jane," he hollered up the stairs. "I'm home. I'll be up in a minute."
"Okay,"
she called. Snickers, the schnauzer, danced around him.
"You want to go outside, don't you? Come on, I'll let you out back where it's fenced."
James didn't have to wait long. The freezing cold had the dog scampering inside the house in minutes and curling up in his warm dog bed. Miss Pickles, the tortoiseshell cat, turned her pink nose in his direction, waited for an ear scratch, then, once satisfied, went right back to her nap. James hung up his coat in the hall closet, retrieved a fork from the kitchen, and ran upstairs to the bedroom. His beautiful wife, Jane, lay propped up in bed, her walnut brown, wavy hair a dark contrast to the pale blue pillowcase. She had a warm, colorful wedding ring quilt pulled up over her belly. She had been reading the latest Lee Child novel, but James noted with a pang of guilt that she had her cell phone at her side.
"James," Jane cried, "I was beginning to worry about you. I thought of phoning, but didn't want to disturb you if you were having a good time."
"I'm sorry, honey. We talked about a new diet and time got away from me. You should have called, or I should have called you."
James hastened to her side, a lump forming in his throat. Sometimes he still couldn't believe that they had found one another again. Jillian was right. When Jane had left him, James had been so hurt, so lost. But the pain had vanished when she'd come back into his life with their little boy. Even though they'd both had other relationships, James had never stopped loving Jane, or she him. Now they'd remarried and were expecting a daughter. He leaned over and kissed his beautiful wife on the lips, then sat on the bed next to her. He couldn't resist placing his hand gently on her belly. He hoped to feel his daughter move, something that never failed to fill him with awe. But she was asleep.
"How are you feeling?"
Jane rolled her eyes, then smiled at her husband.
"I'll be glad when I don't have to hear those words every day. Our little girl hasn't given me any trouble at all, unless you count kicking me the whole time I tried to nap this afternoon. She seems to delight in waiting until I'm trying to sleep before performing somersaults." "What's that you have?"
"Jillian made fruit salad and sent me home with some for you. Do you feel like eating?"
"Hand it over, mister. Sounds delicious."
James took out the yellow vintage Tupperware bowl, removed the lid, and handed it to Jane along with the fork. He reached back into the brown paper bag and found a napkin. "Trust Jillian to think of everything. Is Elliot asleep already?" Jane swallowed a bite of banana and nodded.
"It's almost 9 on a school night. I had to make him go to bed at 8:30. He wanted to show you the magic reading wand he made in class, but I told him it could wait until tomorrow."
James felt his heart plummet. He'd gone to Jillian's straight from work, so he hadn't seen his son since that morning when he'd taken him to the bus. The bus stopped right on the corner outside their house, but Jane and James had decided that, at least for the first year, one of them would stay with Elliot until the bus came and meet him when the bus brought him home. Jane had met Elliot at the bus when he finished school for the day.
"A magic reading wand. I want to see that," James said. "Maybe I could look in on him. I won't wake him."
"Be sure you don't. Let him show you the wand tomorrow morning."
Otherwise, he'll get excited and won't go back to sleep for hours. First, tell me about the new diet.
Jillian came up with the Mediterranean diet.
Oh, I've heard of that. It's supposed to be very healthy.
No desserts.
Jane chuckled. James Henry, you have the biggest sweet tooth in all of Quincy's Gap. I'll bet there aren't any cheese puffs on the diet either.
James paused in the act of unbuttoning his shirt. How did you know I'd fallen off the cheese puff wagon?
Wives know everything, Jane said, mischief in her brown eyes. Okay, maybe the other night when you were massaging my swollen ankles, I might have noticed that your right index finger looked orange.
James groaned.
I'll be happy to go on the diet with you.
You don't have to go on any diet. You're still planning on nursing, aren't you? James asked, concerned that she'd changed her mind. I don't want you depriving yourself.
As I recall, the Mediterranean diet is full of tempting food choices. And of course I'm going to breastfeed our baby girl. But that doesn't give me an excuse to stuff myself with junk food.
Jane squinted and pretended to think hard.
Well, maybe sometimes,
James laughed. Sure I can't get you some pickles and ice cream?
Ugh, Jane grimaced. Neither sounds appealing.
I thought most women craved pickles and ice cream when they were pregnant.
I'm in the minority then, Jane said, and wrinkled her nose. Anything else happened tonight?
James pulled out a pair of warm flannel pajamas from the triple dresser.
He really didn't want to tell Jane about the Bronco not starting.
They'd already had one discussion about replacing the truck. James didn't want to upset his wife.
The Bronco, James? Jane asked.
James's eyes rounded. How did you know?
I told you, wives know everything. Now what happened?
Jillian called to make sure I got home okay, didn't she? James guessed. Jane nodded and forked a slice of orange into her mouth. James adopted a light tone. The truck didn't want to start, but I talked it into behaving. Brought me home fine.
Jane rested the bowl of fruit on her rounded stomach. James, it's time for a new vehicle. I know you said we can't afford it, and I agree that we shouldn't take money out of savings, but I'll continue my distance teaching at JMU after our daughter is born, and that brings in a small income. We'll have a tight budget, but we'll be able to handle a car payment on a used truck if we're careful.
Jane, let's not talk about this now, he said, pulling on his pajama bottoms. You know, I don't want you to have to teach after the baby is born unless you want to.
Which I do. I love teaching. With distance learning, all I need is my laptop to post lectures and grades. You want to wait for the Bronco to break down again?
Pop always says that buying a used car is buying someone else's problems.
That's often true. We can reduce the risk if we have any potential new vehicle checked by a mechanic first.
Please, Jane, let's not have an argument about this now, he pleaded, buttoning the top of his pajamas. I'll take the Bronco back to the mechanic in Harrisonburg tomorrow and tell him what happened. He'll check the truck over.
Jane put the empty Tupperware bowl on the nightstand and picked up her book. All right, but promise me that you'll tell me what he says.
I promise.
James stepped over to the bed, leaned down, and kissed Jane on the forehead.
I love you. I'll go look in on Elliot, then make sure everything's locked up and come to bed.
James crept silently into Elliot's room. In the dim light of Elliot's Curious George nightlight, and the luminous planets and stars on the cobalt-blue ceiling, James could make out the top of his son's head. The rest of him was buried under thick blue covers. James listened to the sound of his son's soft breathing and smiled.
who knew that the sound of a little boy sleeping could delight his ears more than even the most beautiful music. James picked the lion, the witch, and the wardrobe off the floor and placed it on Elliot's bedside table without a sound. He and Jane had been taking turns reading the second book in the Chronicles of Narnia series to Elliot. Although the stories were supposed to be for ages 8 and up, 5-year-old Elliot had comprehended and loved The Magician's Nephew and begged for more. James and Jane had bought a copy of The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe and were already halfway through reading it to Elliot. As he looked at his boy, James wished again that he'd been home to read to Elliot. Easing the door 3/4 of the way closed, James whispered, "I love you, son." When he'd finished checking the locks and turning out lights, he returned to the bedroom. One look told him that his wife had drifted off to sleep. James switched off the lamp and slipped into bed, careful not to wake her. Snuggled under the covers, James said a silent prayer of thanks for his family and friends and asked to be blessed with a healthy baby. The next morning, James surprised the two best library assistants in the world, the Fitzgerald twins, by letting the guys into the library, turning up the heat, and then taking off for Harrisonburg immediately, leaving them in charge. Once there, he drank burnt coffee and resisted the siren call of the vending machine for 2 hours in the shop's waiting room, hoping for a positive verdict on the Bronco from the mechanic. The man finally came into the waiting room, where James had been checking the Star for a feature story on Quincy's Gap with his photo. Gray-haired and short, the mechanic wore stained coveralls and wiped his hands on a dirty rag.
"Mr. Henry, I can't find anything wrong with your truck. No codes coming up on the computer."
James perked up.
"That's good news." "Maybe. Sometimes on these older models, the computer doesn't throw a code. She's got almost 180,000 miles on her. Might be good for another 20,000.
2 years, James estimated.
"Like I said, might be. You bring her back if she acts up again."
James called Jane right away and told her the mechanic said nothing was wrong with the truck. Although she'd said okay, James could tell she wasn't convinced. As he drove back to Quincy's Gap, James smiled as he remembered Elliot's excitement that morning when he showed him the magic reading wand.
"Look, Daddy,"
Elliot had exclaimed, waving the wand in front of his face.
"I can use it two ways, as a bookmark like this."
Elliot grabbed a Dr. Seuss book and demonstrated.
"Or as a pointer while I read. Like this. Here, you can hold it."
The child held out the wand as if bestowing James with the crown jewels. While Elliot pulled on his navy blue sweater, James accepted the wand. Made of a popsicle stick with a cut-out glittery foam star at the end, the wand had been painted blue.
"This is neat, son. Did you glue these hearts and circles on here?"
"Those are moons, Daddy. Like the ones I have on my ceiling," Elliot corrected.
"Right, I see that now."
When James had bought the house, the previous occupants had glow-in-the-dark stickers on the ceiling of what became Elliot's room. James loved to cuddle in bed with his son, while the two looked up at the moon, stars, and planets above and discussed Elliot's day. Elliot talked nonstop about his kindergarten teacher, Mrs. Spaulding, who was pretty and lots of fun, while James made him pancakes and finally got him out the door and on the bus. James had stood and waved at his son until the yellow bus was out of sight. Now he parked the Bronco in front of the Shenandoah County Library. A quick glance at his watch confirmed what his stomach told him. It was almost time for lunch. Luckily, he'd had the foresight to stop at the grocery store before he left Harrisonburg and pick up a Greek-style salad with chicken. James made it past the snack machine that contained mini packages of cheese puffs without making a purchase and walked into his beloved library.
"Hey, Professor!"
Scott Fitzgerald called out. The twins often referred to James as Professor, since before he returned to Quincy's Gap, James had been a professor of English literature at William and Mary College in Williamsburg. James smiled and waved a greeting. He divested himself of scarf, parka, and gloves, put his salad in the break room fridge, then joined the Fitzgerald twins. They stood with Fern Dickinson at the checkout counter cutting red hearts out of construction paper.
"You sure were in a hurry this morning,"
Francis said, a question in his voice. Identical twins, the Fitzgeralds were 27-year-old, long-limbed, brainy bibliophiles who wore tortoiseshell glasses. Each had a bottomless pit for a stomach. They were the best assistants in the world, in James's opinion, and he didn't know how he'd run the library without them. Over the years, they'd become his friends as well as his employees. Heck, James considered them family. Last year, the Fitzgerald twins had won a contest for creating a new video game, and with part of their winnings, had bought cruise tickets to Bermuda for James and Jane as a wedding present.
"Good morning, Fern,"
James greeted the pretty, auburn-haired young woman, who wore the same tortoiseshell-style glasses as Scott and Francis. A talented photographer, she worked part-time at the library and dated Scott.
"Hi, Mr. Henry."
"I had to take the truck into Harrisonburg so the mechanic could check it over," James explained.
"Again?" the twins asked in unison.
"When are you getting new wheels?" Scott asked. "That truck is as old as a PlayStation 1. "Yeah, you could get a brand new Tesla," Francis suggested.
"Not you, too," James grumbled. "The truck is fine, especially for a family. Granted, it's getting older, but a few repairs should keep it on the road." "What are you up to?" he asked, and motioned to the red hearts.
Fern said, "For Valentine's Day, I thought I'd make a wall tree out of paper and use the hearts as leaves. I'll keep the hearts blank in case anyone wants to write their names on them."
Scott slid Francis a look. James believed they had a silent way of communicating, and he was pretty sure the two were not excited about the upcoming romantic holiday.
"That's a great idea, Fern," James said, moving behind the counter and admiring their handiwork. "Where are you thinking of putting it?"
"I thought it was time to take down my wall of photos," she said, indicating a collage of photos of library patrons. During the Christmas season, the twins had fashioned a photo booth where patrons could have their pictures taken by Fern. Later, the creative young woman had created the collage.
"Tell her that's a bad idea, Professor," Scott said, laying his scissors down on the counter. "Everyone likes seeing themselves on the library wall, and they're seriously cool photos. We can put the, Valentine tree over near the romance section."
"I have to agree with Scott, Fern," James said,
accepting late fees from a patron and handing over their scanned books and receipts with a smile. He turned and looked at the photos on the wall, prepared to further his case, when a thought struck him. Had Murphy been in the library since Fern put up her creative display? Had she stolen Fern's idea of photographing the locals? If so, why? At that moment, Bennett, dressed in his postal uniform, strode into the library, a magazine in his hand, and a look of thunder on his face.
"Excuse me," he said to the twins and Fern. "James, I need to borrow you for a minute. You better look at this right now. That Murphy, I knew she was up to no good."
James and Bennett moved down the counter.
James accepted a copy of Southern Style magazine from Bennett, his heart rate kicking up. The glossy cover had a photo of the Hearth and Home cast members posed in the house the show had been filmed in. They were grouped in the kitchen, smiling, under a wooden sign that read, "All because two people fell in love."
"Look at the articles listed on the side," Bennett ground out.
James read aloud, "Hearth and Home's 30th Anniversary Reunion. Best-selling author Murphy Alastair on her new book, Murder in the Caverns." He turned the magazine over. The entire back page was the colorful cover of Murphy's new book. James knew the story would be a fantastical retelling of a murder investigation the supper club had conducted after finding a dead body at Luray Caverns a few years ago. Murphy's previous book had been equally horrible, but wildly popular. James looked at Bennett in dismay.
"She started the publicity for her new book in a big way." "That's bad, but you missed this," Bennett said impatiently.
He flipped the magazine back to its front and tapped his fingers on the third feature, which read in large red capital letters,
"Five Best Undiscovered Small Towns You Should Be Living in."
In smaller letters underneath were the words, "Including Murphy Alastair's own Quincy's Gap."
"What?" James said,
confusion turning to anxiety.
"Southern Style has named Quincy's Gap one of the best small towns to live in?"
Bennett snatched the magazine from his hand.
"Look at this!"
He flipped through pages and held open the magazine. In bright blue letters were the words,
"Quincy's Gap, mountains, apples, farms, cheap land. Wouldn't you want to live among the friendliest people in Virginia?"
And there they all were, James, Lucy, Bennett, Jillian, and Lindy, and in a smaller shot, Jackson and Milla. Murphy had given the photos she'd taken of everyone at their jobs to Southern Style for the feature on Quincy's Gap and the promotion of her new book. She had never intended to use the photos in the store, and she'd gotten the idea from Fern's innocent wall of photos in the library. Outrage ran through James. Scott and Francis had snuck over behind him and had been reading over his shoulder.
"Wow, Professor, you're famous. Southern Style is based out of Louisville, Kentucky, but it's sold all over the country, not only in the South."
Francis said,
"That TV show reunion is next week in Cardinal's Rest at the Redbird B&B. That's 20 minutes southwest of here. Willow told me they're making extra candy at Quincy's Whimsies for tourists. I'd better call her and tell her to expect a tsunami of people coming to see the best undiscovered small town, as well as those celebrities." "That Murphy," Bennett said through gritted teeth.
James quickly scanned the article. It made Quincy's Gap, population 2026, soon to be 2027, sound very appealing. Good schools, low crime, picturesque, all of which was true. James could imagine lots of people across the country reading about his town and rushing to buy up property. Hordes of people. Developers buying land and building new subdivisions, new apartments, new office buildings. When they were done, James wouldn't even recognize the town he'd grown up in, the town he loved, where he planned to raise his children. And he and his friends would have played an unwitting part in the nightmare that awaited them. Anger gripped him. "Bennett, you're delivering this magazine today to subscribers?"
"Yeah, and the grocery stores and drug stores are getting it today, too. Some sort of rush deal. We need to get together and talk about this."
James nodded in agreement, his head reeling.
"This calls for an emergency meeting of the supper club. I'll send out emails right away, suggesting we go to Mama Mia's restaurant for dinner. See you then."
In the meantime, I've got a fresh box of donut holes to eat.
Bennett trudged out of the library and into the cold. James stared at the magazine. He wouldn't be the only one angered by what Murphy had done. Besides his friends, other townsfolk were bound to be up in arms over this kind of publicity for Quincy's Gap and what it might mean for all their futures. Murphy had better watch her back. Chapter 3. James walked into his childhood home with Jane and Elliot. The smell of cilantro, coming from a big pot heating on the stove, met his nostrils. He welcomed the warmth, not only of the comfortable, homey kitchen, but also of Milla's smile.
"James and Jane, come in out of that awful cold," Milla said, wiping her hands on her apron.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.